Howdy everyone and welcome back. This time I'm covering the Royal Ludroth, then the Royal Ludroth subspecies. Now, the few things you want to know about Royal Ludroth: it has a water element, can inflict water blight, which causes your stamina to recover at a slower rate, and it's weakest to fire then thunder. Now, with Ludroth, its attacks are somewhat similar to that of the Lagiochrist, so if you've ever fought one of those before, then you'd know. First attack there is a kind of swipe with its forearm, and the other where it kind of rolls its body at you. That attack can actually roll towards the side as a small circle, like a kind of quarter circle, which you'll see later on. And this attack, where it kind of gathers all the water in its mane, it smashes down when it has a small area of effect, which I believe that can actually inflict water blight as well. Yeah, I've already got it, if you can see in the top left. And it basically slows your stamina recovery, as I have said. Now, its attacks aren't too bad there. That, I say that one is one of the more annoying attacks, where it can reach you at a fairly considerable distance. It kind of flails its body at you. There again, the paw swipe. I don't know why I said paw swipe. My bad. That's the attack where it rolls its body. It can actually turn slightly to actually get towards you. So that's one thing you'll have to kind of be aware of when fighting the Ludroth. Its attack here, it's kind of, it swings its body and then hits you with its tail, and then sometimes it can actually lead to a tail whip attack, as you just saw there, which kind of reminds me of Teostret, oddly enough. That attack you saw there, it rarely happens when it's not in rage mode, but it can actually happen. And this attack will just basically charge at you head on. It's fairly easy to avoid, just need to kind of keep an eye on it from a distance when it happens. Now, that attack I just slowed down just to show you that it can also be applied to that of the subspecies variant, however it contains poison. And just like Lagiochrist, it has a the Royal Ludroth has a slight ranged attack where it kind of shoots a water ball at you, and this attack, similar to that of the Gyrosaurus, where it kind of runs around frantically and shooting, well, as it was poison spit bombs, but this was like kind of water spits. I don't know technical terms, but I know how to kind of explain it, I suppose. And there again, the Royal Ludroth subspecies does the exact same, but with poison. Now, this is a slowed down version just to show you the sort of range, and sometimes the actual attack does stay there, so if you run into it, then you'll basically get the water blight again. So you want to kind of keep an eye on that, just so that you don't actually, get affected by it. But it's not terribly bad, but it's also dependent on the weapon that you use. Some weapons, it doesn't particularly matter with stamina, some it does, so you just want to remember that when fighting the Royal Ludroth. So in terms of breakable parts, you've got the crest, you've got the mane, and you've got the tail. Now, some people might only consider the mane a breakable part and not actually know the crest is there. So the crest is basically like kind of small spikes just coming from above its head, and I've already got them broken there, as you can see. Yes, this attack, it's better to not stand where I was standing and just block it or dodge out of the way, because that rarely happens where you can actually avoid it. And here we go, the tail can be cut off. And the mane, which we'll see later on, it's basically the spongy area around it that you can see. That is the mane. I think I break it off on the subspecies. I guess I haven't broken it off on here. But that's it. In terms of attacks with a blade, the most damage can be dealt on the mane. Whereas with a blunt weapon, it'll be the head itself. So some people may be confused that if you attack the mane, it's part of the head. No, it's not. So here we've got the Royal Ludroth subspecies, and you can see it's got similar attacks to the Royal Ludroth. All the attacks are similar, you can apply them in the exact same way. However, you have to remember that this can inflict poison. I believe you can block it, so if it's... yeah, there you go. I basically kind of countered it in a way, but it was still blocked. So you can avoid the poison if you can block the attack. But if not, then just bring antidotes and the whatnot. Me, myself, I never really bring antidotes and such. I just kind of wait it out or heal over. For some reason, that's just me. So here, I think I got attacked first from the actual slam rather than the poison, but because I was in that counter stance, I didn't get affected. Here I did. So there you have it. The Royal Ludo subspecies doesn't have an element as such, though it can inflict a poison element, which you should know by now. It's weakest to fire, then second weakest to thunder, I believe. So again, it's similar to the Royal Ludroth. And in terms of breakable parts, it's identically similar to that of the Royal Ludroth. So the crest, the mane, and the tail. Now in terms of damage with particular weapon types, if you're using a bladed weapon, then you do the most damage on the mane. Whereas if you are using a blunt weapon, you do the more damage on the head. Now, you just need to remember that the head is completely separated from the mane when you use a blunt weapon. So, some people may not know that. I thought I would just point that out there. Let's see. In terms of tips, I suppose what I could give you is that most of the attacks that both the Royal Ludroth and the subspecies variant have is that their attacks are fairly close range, except for one or two attacks. Now that means that you can easily dodge roll or even block the attacks if you're too close. So you just want to, I mean, it might take a couple fights, but you just have to basically try and get used to the fact that you need to anticipate when certain moves can actually happen. For example, usually when it charges at you, it can sometimes turn into basically a tail whip, or it can even turn around and charge you again. It's just the fact that with every monster, it's the same question. You need to anticipate when certain moves happen or when they even don't. And there, for example, is when the mane is broken. And it looks exactly the same on both subspecies and the original version of it, that some parts look like they're slightly chopped off. So you need to remember that. But, I mean, in terms of that, I think that's mostly everything covered, so, yeah. I think that's mostly it. If you have any questions or comments, please leave them down below. I'll be happy to read them and respond, like I usually try to do with most comments. If not, please like and share if this video has helped you in any way. So, I will see you next time, where I should be covering the Kurupeku, so the first actual monster in the game, I suppose. Now, video on the left is a subscriber interactive where I answered a Monster Hunter question and showed some information regarding Monster Hunter 3G. Now, I know I used Call of Duty gameplay, but it's because I don't use Monster Hunter gameplay to have a slight kind of conversation with you guys. I'd rather use that in place of it. But if you want me to use Monster Hunter gameplay for a subscriber interactive video, let me know. Links will be in the description to where you can post questions that I can actually answer for you in a video form. Now, playlist on the right is the weapon guides that I created for Monster Hunter Portable 3rd. So if you have trouble, or if you want to learn slightly more about a weapon that you preferably like to use, go for it and check those out. However, I shall speak to you next time, guys. Bye.